Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading A Strange Friend, which I found right here in the old camp in the Undercity Barracks. It is of great importance to me that some events of my past life will not be forgotten. Thus I have written down some of them on the following pages with further notes to be found elsewhere. If you can understand what I am telling you, my wishes are fulfilled. I grew up in Nerim, in a small abbey hidden deep in the Fold Valley, covering the Middle Realm in the south up to the large mountains. All that I know of my parents is that they died when I was very young in an attack, in a fire. The education by the monks was strict and marked by authority and obedience. When I didn't learn their virtues as good and fast as they liked, they sometimes let the cane speak to help me understand. They said that only if I truly realized their virtues, I will be able to live by the path. It did not really help that the monks themselves lived a life far from their preaching of obedience, diligence, belief, abstinence, honesty, prudence, timeliness, and justice. They drank and ate a lot and avoided work whenever possible. If I, however, let my duties slip just a bit, they got angry quickly. Thus I had difficulties to deal with this hypocrisy, as it left me in constant doubt of any moral guidance. I then approached one of the monks, who seemed a bit less corrupt to me than the rest, and talked to him about my problems. He seemed to understand me well, we talked a lot, and he pitied my situation, even though he tried to put my accusations in perspective. A few days later, however, when the monks got drunk again for whatever reason, he became talkative and spoke to the others about my complaints. Obviously, the rest of the evening wasn't a very comfortable one for me. As the last one of them became too drunk to grab and beat me, I fled into the woods. I had become anxious. In the rush, I took a fur blanket and a piece of cheese with me on my way uphill to a remote clearing in the forest, and I was glad that I did so. When I arrived, I looked for a dry place to sleep, ate some of the cheese, and quickly lay down in the moon shadow of the ledge beside me, even though I knew nobody would find me here or search after me at all. I just wanted to hide. The darkness and the invisible vibrancy of the forest didn't bother me, however. Wolves and bears didn't live in this part of the woods, and none of the other animals cared about me. Just now that I lay down still, with the blanket wrapped around me, and staring into the vast sky above me, I felt all those bruises. Everything hurt a bit, but the uniformity of the pain let it slip out of my consciousness quickly, and I fell asleep. I cannot clearly remember any dreams before this one, and maybe this helped to set it apart, so that I can still recall it in the most vibrant way today. It was night, and moderate rain was falling as I walked on an island. Around me I saw burned and partially overgrown ruins of houses. A roughly paved road led through this color and lifeless solitude towards a large tower. It was just as weathered and overgrown, but had not collapsed, possibly due to the massive rough walls on the lower floors. The rain and wind left me freezing, so I looked for a way inside. After climbing over some fallen stone pillars, I found a gap in the walls that led into the darkness inside, and I entered. Once inside, it quickly became quiet, and all I could hear was the faint howling of the wind. As my eyes adjusted to the darkness, I could see that it wasn't completely dark, actually. A faint blue-greenish light filled a large hall in front of me, even though I couldn't make out a source for it. I could see some tables and chairs made of stone, and some wooden furniture that had almost decayed to dust. What kind of place was this, and how long has it been abandoned? While I looked at this eerie scene, someone tapped my shoulder. Immediately I turned around and stumbled a few steps to the back. There I saw him, wearing a richly ornamented gray-golden armor, long black hair, eyes fierce and full of wisdom, and black cloth covering his mouth. Then he spoke to me. "Oh, who has come to visit me here? Looks like someone got lost in my tower. But tell me yourself, what are you looking for here?" Anxiously I told him that I was freezing out in the cold rain, and I was looking for some shelter. I also told him about my situation in the abbey. Then I noticed that I was actually dreaming. I know that you are dreaming, but does it make any difference? I am talking to you, and when you wake up, when the first rays of sunlight will strike your face, you will remember my words. Why your dream brought you here, I cannot tell you, but I see it as a sign for me to help you. I didn't know how this strange figure in my dream could help me at all, but the odd warrior then spoke to me. You are worried and confused by the obscurity and inconsistency of reality, my child. Who you are, how you can make something out of your life, and what that could be? Whom are you supposed to obey, and whom not? And why do humans often act so contradictory, irrational, and impulsive? And what is your position in this strange play of life? Well, I have found answers to some of those questions and similar ones. No answers in the way the monks would give them to you, but I am confident that they will help you a lot. However, I have to point out that many of those answers will seem unsatisfying at first. You will have to give up a lot of what you believe now, and you will have to simply believe me blindly in some points. You have to decide for yourself if you are interested in my help at all, but if you are, we will see you again soon. But now hurry, so you can get back to the abbey before the monks wake up and notice your disappearance. With these words, the dream ended. The pale walls of the tower disappeared into a reddish haze, the color of sunrise, as it passed through my closed eyelids. I did still lie on the clearing in the forest, just where I fell asleep, and the sun was about to strike the trees. Quickly I stood up, rolled up the fur blanket, and ate the rest of the cheese as I hurried down the path to the abbey. I reached my small chamber unnoticed and laid down on my bed, as if I was sleeping. Just a few moments later, the door crashed open, and the cook bawled with his raspy voice that I should get a bucket of water from the well and help him in the kitchen. I simply obeyed his requests, silently, and thought about my dream the whole time, and especially wondered about the strange figure, this warrior that spoke to me. After I spent the hours in the kitchen to prepare lunch for all, and after all of the tired and probably still drunk monks finished their meal, it was time for a rest. During the hour of rest at noon, the monks typically did not go to their regular beds, but spend the time somewhere in and around the abbey, relaxing in a place of their choice, possibly in the library or the garden, or praying at one of the many small altars that was set up all around. I, however, went up to the attic of the large main building, a familiar place that was warm and cozy now, as the sun was shining of the roof. I often fled from my mistreatment, and there, in a rather inaccessible corner of the attic, I discovered the perfect place of rest for me. I brought some straw and old clothes up there some time ago and simply enjoyed the calmness and peace up there. And as I lay close to the large bell that marked the end of the daily hour of rest, I always got up in time for the subsequent work on the afternoon. There, in my comfy place in the attic, breathing the warm, heavy, and dusty air, sweetened by smell of the old wooden roof, I contemplated my dream. The more I thought about it, the more I realized just how correct that figure from my dream was, and what he told me about my own problems. Through his words, I realized my situation. Within me, I felt something rise up, the wish to become something, to achieve something, to understand more of the world and free myself from the dubious teachings of the monks. I thought about the legends of those who, despite harsh conditions, achieved great things, like Lorem Waterblade, who, despite being manufacturer, became a keeper of the Holy Order. Even though the realization just started back then, at the heart of these thoughts sat the desire for freedom, to be free of the burden of morality, as it was taught to me, free of the stupid ideals of good and bad, which led the action of so many people. And as absurd as it may seem, I really had hope that this figure in my dream could help me. With that in mind, I fell asleep, sure to see him again. I also remember this dream clearly. Again, I was standing on this stormy, rainy, remote island, but this time right before the overgrown tower. Without hesitation, I entered at the same place as before, and inside, everything looked unchanged to me. After my eyes had adjusted to the darkness again, I saw my friend sitting at the head of the long stone table in the middle, but everything still was only illuminated by that faint blue-greenish light. As I approached him, I saw him smile for a moment, then I sat down to his left, on a stone chair. Look, you have returned to me, and I already waited for you. I see the fire in your eyes, the eagerness, but before we continue, I want to warn you again. Even though curiosity and a desire for freedom are honorable traits, they can develop into a pursuit of endless personal freedom and power. Some want to reach for the stars just after the first steps towards liberation, and by exactly this euphoria of achieving something large, of surpassing others, of being superior, a dangerous narcissism is fed. Violent fights, even wars, have been led under the banner of freedom. And in most cases, the leaders of these conflicts wanted to channel this diffuse, undirected desire for freedom and superiority, which they ignited in their followers, simply for their own benefit, to gain more power themselves. So be watchful in whom you trust, and under which banner you put your eagerness. Initially, that banner should be your own mind. The banner of my own mind? I guess the next weeks and months, maybe years, will be a turbulent time for you. But do you think you will stay in the Abbey much longer? The world outside has a lot to offer, my child. But again, there are many liars and preachers of falsehood and nonsense out there, constantly looking for directionless and naive people to convince. You, however, should keep to yourself for now, in modesty. I didn't know what to think about this. Was I really such a naive person? I certainly was doubtful regarding the words of the monks. But even though I felt uncomfortable in the Abbey, the thought of leaving and traveling into the unknown by myself made me uneasy. You might not trust the monks a lot, as you know them and their contradicting behavior well, but what about seasoned speakers you have never met before? They know people like you very well. Just be careful. And regarding your uneasiness of traveling alone, try to find the reasons for your fears and concerns, and try to make important decisions with your conscious mind, not by intuition and emotion. Deciding by intuition is certainly faster and easier, but you do see the results every day. We talked a lot in this way about many different topics, about the various virtues I was taught by the monks, the reasons for their behavior, about what I could eventually accomplish out there, about all the problems the people on Vin had since ancient times. He said that when people speak of the light of religious revelation, it is to be understood rather as blindness, a mind-numbing brightness, a distracting glare. In the shadows, however, the eyes are more sensitive, and the mind is full awake. We didn't always agree, though, and he sometimes asked me to refuse his statements with reason. Sometimes, when I wouldn't believe him, he gave me a task for the day, for example, something to ask the monks, and most of the time his predictions of their answers were correct. Our dialogues took place on various places on that stormy, deserted island. Sometimes we stood outside, between the ruins, sat in the basement of one of the burnt-down houses, or climbed up to the top of the tower, staring at the vast, empty sea around us. I do not know whether these dreams were really dreams, or how these vivid images entered my mind, but deep within me, I believe that this island really exists somewhere out there, whatever its history was. But why was it me who dreamt to be there? Why were it my dreams he entered? Why did he help me? Was it by chance or by fate? As a consequence of our talks, I soon planned to leave the Abbey. Again and again, I went into the library and looked for books on the other regions of Nerim. I read travel reports from Cape Ammon in the northeast to the Seagate in the South Realm. One day, between two old, roughly bound books, I found a map of the entire continent which contained many roads and smaller routes. Even though the map was probably a very old one, I made great use of it, as I secretly copied it with all the details I found important, adding further knowledge I had gained. Then my plan was set. I wanted to travel to the north, passing by Gilead and Salen, and finally reaching the capital, Orothen. I already had a rich and detailed imagination of what the capital would look like, with all its alleys and houses, and its people, even though I knew it would actually look completely different. I thought of the great bridge to the city, of the big cathedral by the marketplace, and of its harbor in the north. Even though the monks had me suffering a lot, I didn't want to leave them completely clueless about my disappearance. After all, they provided me with food and shelter for about 20 winters. I put a short notice on my bed that I would leave, and probably not return, and on my favorite spot, an attic about a longer letter with some more explanations on my motivation, though I don't know if it has been found yet, or if it will be found at all. And then I left into the unknown. My dreams and visions helped me a lot, even though they made me anything but religious in the ordinary sense. I learned a lot about the nature of authorities, about the power of emotions, and how to keep in control of the negative consequences. And I was free. Sure, in view of what most see as living by the path, seeing the light and revelation of the gods, I lived a life of shadows. But I eventually mastered the shadows, and I am satisfied with the path I took. After all, I learned from a true shadow god. Even now that I write down these lines, I can hear the keepers of the order, how they condemn my tale. So, dear reader, please take care of whom you tell about this. The world is full of fools. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, A Strange Friend.